To the online sessions on signals and systems. In today's class we will complete unit number 1. Okay, so we left over with 3 to 4 topics now, and those topics we will try to cover in this today's session. In the previous session, what is that we discussed? In the previous session we discussed about some special signals of importance. What are the special signals of importance that we have discussed? Unit step function, unit impulse function, sinusoidal function, and a complex exponential function. So these functions we have discussed in the previous class. I just wanted to have a recap once again of those functions. So what is unit step function? It is a function whose values are going to be equal to 1 for all t greater than or equal to 0. It is simply known as a unit step function. It can also be called as a Heaviside function. The next one is unit impulse function, also known as a Dirac delta function or delta function, which is denoted by d. And this function is normally going to have a value 1 represented by delta of t and represented by delta of t. So delta of t will be equal to 1 for all the time periods t not equal to 0. And pictorially, how we represent that particular function? It is simply an impulse signal. Means what? Simply an arrow mark is going to be there. So that is what the impulse signal. And this value is going to be 1 over the limits minus infinity plus infinity. When you apply the integration, when you find out the area of the signal over the limits minus infinity plus infinity, you should get a value equal to 1. If you're going to get a value is equal to 1 under the finite duration of the time period, then we normally going to say that signal is known as a impulse signal. Now this signal is once again can be represented in this manner, which is nothing but a delayed version of the delayed impulse signal with respect to time period. So this impulse signal with strength k is delayed with respect to 0. That means with respect to this signal, it is a delayed version of the impulse signal. So therefore I can write this as delta of t minus t naught. If it is time advancement, means what? If it is coming prior to this, if this particular signal is coming prior to this, what I'll write now? This function I'll write to the left side of 0. When I write this to the left side of 0, then what does it mean now? It is nothing but time advancement. So this is coming prior to the 0. When you move from left side to right side in this direction, when you move, this signal is coming first. Therefore, it is known as a time advanced signal, where I can represent this function. If it is placed here, I can represent this function as delta of t plus t naught. So pictorially, I can simply represent this particular function like this. Okay, so this is what function we discussed in the last class. And next we discussed about sinusoidal function. Cos and sine are going to be sinusoidal in nature. Therefore, I write the cos function. Now this cos is a function of a sinusoidal nature with a time period t is equal to 2 pi by omega, and a fundamental frequency is equal to f, or 2 pi f. Omega is angular frequency, so which is equal to 2 pi f, where f is going to be the fundamental frequency of this particular signal. So if theta is equal to 0, what will happen now? That means the sine value is going to have a maximum value at theta is equal to 0. That means you should have this function over here. That means this maximum value will be coming over the other part. This maximum part of signal will be coming at 0 line, 0 axis of the time period. Then it is going to be theta is equal to 0. Now since theta is not is equal to 0, now we got some variation here, right? Just simply show the variation with that particular theta, having it shown in the pictorial representation. This is what one of the sinusoidal signal we have. Then next we have discussed about a complex signals, complex exponential signals. What do you mean by complex exponential signal? Whenever you say exponential signal, you should get into the mind that something should be there with e to the power. E to the power, something is there, means what? That type of signal comes under exponential signal. Whenever you say there is a complex thing, means the term j, imaginary term j, should come in the expression. So therefore, I can represent the generalized continuous time complex signal as equal to x of t is equal to a into e power lambda t. Now here, as this function is dependent on e power something, we call it as a exponential signal. Now if a and lambda are going to be real values, if a and lambda are going to be real values, then we normally going to get a real complex exponential signal. If a and lambda are going to be complex in nature, we normally going to get a complex valued exponential signal. So therefore we have two cases here. For example, as special case, complex exponentials include real exponentials and complex sinusoids. So first of all, we discussed in the previous class about the real exponential. It is a special case of the complex exponential signal representation. So therefore, we can write this x of t is equal to a into e power sigma t. So now where a and lambda are going to be restricted to the real numbers. If it is so, if you imagine that a is going to be a finite value, if you imagine that a is going to be a finite value, then what is that you are going to have now? If a is going to be finite value, now the value purely depends on the that lambda. So if lambda is going to be greater than 0, so what is that equation you are going to have? E power lambda means lambda is increasing. So to what level lambda can increase? Lambda can increase up to infinity. What is e power infinity? It is going to be infinity. So that means this function should start from 0, and as lambda value is going to increase, this function value should also increase exponentially towards infinity. So therefore, this function is simply going to be called as a exponentially increasing function. It is going to be called as exponentially increasing function or exponentially growing function, or called, can be called as a growing exponential function. So we normally going to get a mode called growing exponential function if lambda greater than 0. If lambda is equal to 0, what is e power 0? E power 0 is equal to 1. Therefore, we get a constant signal called a here. That means with amplitude a, we going to get a constant signal called a uniform signal. So if lambda is equal to 0, if lambda is less than 0, what will happen now? What is e power minus infinity? It is going to be 0. That means e power minus infinity means what? 0. So therefore, as lambda is normally going to decrease, then normally you normally going to experience a decreasing exponential signal. So this is what a signal representation for decreasing exponential. So all these are real exponential signals. Now you are going to have one more exponential signal called as complex exponential signals, or complex sinusoidal is a special case of the complex exponentials. We include complex sinusoidal signals here for this expression. This is a general expression for the exponential signal representation, right? Now I'll include the complex sinusoid. When I say complex sinusoid, the sign, the wave of waveform is varying with respect to time period. So if it is complex, what is that I tell you? When something is complex, please add j term. So if it is exponential, it should be something like e to the power something. So e to the power j omega t, if you write, this signal is normally going to become a complex exponential signal. Because of j, it becomes complex. Because of e to the power, it becomes exponential. And hence, we simply call this signal as a exponential complex exponential signal. We call it as a complex exponential signal. Now if a is also going to be complex, how I can write a as equal to a, I can write as equal to a into e power j theta. So when I write this a into e power j theta for a, now I can write this mod a or a into e power j omega t into e power j theta. So when I have two exponentials, I can add the numerators directly. So therefore, I can say e power j omega t plus theta is a representation for the complex sinusoidal signal. So now the same thing can be written by using the Euler's relationship, as e power j theta is nothing but equal to cos theta plus j sin theta. That is the Euler's relationship. So using that relationship, I can just simply write these two forms, where first one without j is nothing but the real part, second one with j is known as the imaginary part. So this is what the representation for the signal using Euler's relationship for the exponential, for the complex exponential signal with sinusoidal nature. Now this is the waveform which we can simply write. Already we have discussed about this. So cos function, see cos function, if cos function is having without theta, means what? Maximum value you are going to get at t is equal to 0. Sine function, if you are going to get without theta value, then you normally going to have a 0 value, because sine 0 is nothing but 0, so you are going to get at 0 value. So therefore, we can write the sine and cos functions based on the angle theta. So like this we can represent the both the functions. Now next case is going to be what now? Complex exponential, where a and lambda both are going to be complex in nature. If lambda is complex in nature, then what will happen now? If lambda is complex in nature, right, so if lambda is complex in nature, yeah, if lambda is complex in nature, we'll write lambda as a real and imaginary part. So therefore, we'll simply write this lambda is equal to sigma plus j omega, and a I can write as equal to a into e power j omega, where a and sigma are going to be complex in nature. So in the previous case, omega is going to be real value, but here it is not going to be real value, it is going to be imaginary value. So therefore, we normally going to have a complete relationship in terms of sigma and all. So this sigma plus j omega I can write as equal to s. Okay, for the Laplace transforms and z transform, for Laplace transform representation, I can write this as S, but right now we are not discussing about that, so let's not bother about it. Now, how can I write this in the Eulers relationship now? How can I write this as equal to now total expression x of t is equal to, how can I write this as? I can write x of t is equal to a into e raised to power lambda e raised to power what now? Sigma plus j omega plus theta into t. So all that is what I am going to get. So sigma t plus e to the power sigma t plus theta j plus j theta plus j omega t. So all these things I get now. So here extra thing is that this sigma part is coming. So therefore the sigma part I can take it on the other side of the cos function. Rest of the thing is normally going to be a cos signal. So therefore I can represent this as a e to the power sigma t. Say for example, if sigma is equal to 0, you will go to the previous equation only. Sigma is equal to lambda is equal to j omega, you go to the previous equation. So only thing is extra is sigma is added. So therefore I am writing with a sigma as a relationship. So this is the complete relationship for the complex exponential signal when everything is going to be complex in nature, right? Now, based on once again the value of sigma, this is normally going to have three modes of operations. So we normally going to get three modes of, it's going to exhibit three modes of behavior depending on the values of sigma. If sigma is equal to 0, it is normally going to be only real sinusoids. Only the real sinusoids you normally going to get. If the sigma is going to be greater than 0, same as the previous case, sigma is greater than 0, e power infinity, it will be going up to infinity. So therefore, you are going to have the real sinusoids plus exponentially increasing part. So therefore, you are normally going to get a exponentially increasing kind of a signal here for sigma greater than 0. If sigma less than 0, exponentially decaying signal you are going to get. So this is what the complete exponential complex signals representations. The next one is relationship between the complex exponentials and real sinusoids. What is real sinusoid? Cos theta, say sin theta, or cos omega t, sin omega t, are known as the real sinusoids. I want to represent them I have to represent them in terms of the complex exponentials. How can I represent? I can write this cos theta is equal to cos theta in the form of cos theta is equal to e power j theta plus e power minus j theta by 2. That is the form I have. So I can write the in that form. So here instead of theta I have omega t plus theta. I can expand that in that particular formula to have a relationship between complex exponentials for a cos and sine representations. So what about sine theta? Sine theta is equal to e power minus j theta by 2j. That is the formula we have. So using that formula, just replace theta with omega t plus theta, you normally going to get a representation for the complex exponentials in terms of exponential relationships. So this is what regarding the complex exponential signals. Now next one is going to be some other special signals we have known as time limited signals. What is the meaning of time limited signals? A time limited signal is nothing but is known as a signal whose values are going to exist between two limits of time period. Between two time periods only the signal is normally going to have. So for this we have to understand two types of signals. One is going to be called as a right sided signal, next one is going to be a left sided signal. So what is right sided signal? If at all any signal is going to exist for a time period, if at all any signal does not exist for a time period t less than t naught, for a time period t less than t naught. See here, for a time period t less than t naught, you are not going to have any signal. For a time period t greater than t naught, you normally going to have a signal. This is t naught. For all time period t greater than t naught, you normally going to have a signal. That is nothing but a right sided signal. Means what? You are going to experience a signal which is right side, which is normally going right side with respect to t naught. With respect to t naught, the signal is going towards right side, is going to be right sided signal. Exactly reverse is going to be for left sided signal. So see the left sided signal now. This is left sided signal. So that means the value of the signal is going to be 0 for all time periods, for all the time periods t greater than t naught. For t greater than t naught, there is no signal. The signal is going to exist only when t is going to be less than t naught. So that means it is known as a left-sided signal. Now, what about time-limited signal? Time-limited signal is known as a combination of both left and right sided signals. So if you combine these two, you normally going to get a time limited signal. So therefore, a signal with it is both left sided and right sided is simply known as a time limited signal. Very important for the examination point of view. That is why I am writing here, see here, in the left sided signals I have t naught. Here the same thing I have represented with t1. And the right sided signals, this is t naught is right sided signal, t1 signal is left sided signal. So these two are combined. So therefore, this is nothing but a time limited signal, which is nothing but both left sided as well as right sided signal. And last one is going to be two sided signal. What is two sided signal? The signal is going to extend over the left side as well as right side continuously over the infinite duration of time period. That is known as a two sided signal. So this is what regarding the special signals that what we have. And other things, other special signals, we are going to have a bounded signals. What is bounded signal? If you find out the modulus of a signal, you should get some finite value. So if you are going to get some value, then it is known as a finite signal that we have. And in that category we have two types of signals called as sine and cos. Both of them are known as bounded signals. And other signals such as fan signal is going to be called as unbounded signals, because it is not going to give us a finite value at every instance of time period. Therefore, it is going to be unbounded signal. And other signals which is normally going to support the non-constant polynomial functions, okay, are known as the something like, you know, unbounded signals. And energy and power signals once again comes under the bounded signals. Okay, so why? Because the value, that means if you find out the area of a square of the signal, find out area of square of the signal, you should get a value. If you are going to get a value, that is known as energy signal. Since energy is finite, now we simply call it as a energy signal. Similarly is going to be the power. If you find out the average value of the area, whatever we have got for the signal, over a time period t tends to infinity, then you should get a value. If you are going to get a value, then it is known as a power signal. That means the power, a signal with finite average power is said to be a power signal. So if you find out this value, if you find out the power value, then it is known as a power signal. Okay, this is what the representations of energy and the power signals. Then next one is going to be introduction to the discrete time signals. What is discrete time signal? Discrete time signal is a signal which is going to exist only in the finite duration of time period, not in the continuous time period duration. So I've given you two signal representations here, continuous time and a discrete time signal representations. If you see continuous time, the signal values are going to exist for at each and every instance of time period. Whereas when you come to discrete time, the signal is going to have values only at discrete instance of time period. So these two are the main differences between discrete time and the continuous time signal. So therefore, discrete time signal with discrete independent variables. Now all these are discrete variables. Based on these independent variables, we normally going to get a value called function. So that is why, since time is continuous in nature, we will write here as x of t. Whereas for discrete signal, we represent with n. Instead of t, we represent with n, because n is going to take discrete values, 1, 2, 3, 4, like that. So what is the example of a discrete signal that we are going to have now? It is going to be stock market index. Stock market index is normally going to be not continuous in nature. It is going to be discrete in nature. Then discrete valued signal is said to be digital signal. So we can just get a digital signal from the discrete value signal, which is going to be digital audio signal. Then next, how we represent the digital signal? We always represent digital signal extending between minus infinity plus infinity. In the case of time domain, we say minus infinity to plus infinity. Here also we can just say minus infinity plus infinity. We represent that signal by using sigma. There we represent the signal by using integration symbol. Here we are going to represent by using a summation signal. That is what the important difference that we have to really look into. So a signal x of n. Now in the case of continuous time, we say x of t. Here in the case of discrete time, we say x of n. That is what the representation for discrete time signal is called, a periodic signal. If there exists a real integer n such that x of n plus n naught will be equal to x of n, where what is n naught? N naught is going to be the n naught is going to be the fundamental fundamental integral value with the fundamental period as 2 pi by n naught. So now here I am represented a signal called impulse signal. So this impulse signal is going to exist at a particular value of n. So therefore delta of n I have represented here as a impulse signal. So there is going to exist an impulse at n is equal to 0. If this is the n axis, so if n is equal to 0, you are normally going to have a impulse signal. If you normally going to have an impulse signal at n is equal to 0, then it is simply called as impulse signal. So the value is going to be 0 for all n not equal to 0. That means towards left side, towards right side, for all these points, the value of the signal is equal to 0. Therefore, it is known as an impulse type of the signal. So, discrete time impulse signal also known as Kroker-Nicker delta function. There is another name given to this discrete impulse function known as Kroker-Nicker delta function. There is another name given to the continuous impulse train known as delta function. Here it is known as Kroker-Nicker delta function. So, is a function in the ordinary sense. It has a sampling property. Now, it is normally going to have a sampling property. What do you mean by sampling? Chopping of the signal at a finite duration of time is known as the sampling. So, chopping means what? Cutting. You are going to cut the signal at a finite instance of time and you will be taking only the values at finite duration, instances only. Then we simply call it as a sampling. So, therefore, this discrete time impulse is normally going to support the sampling property. The sampling property. So, we discuss this sampling property later on, just in a while now. Now, in the case of sampling, what is that basically? Sampling means cutting the signal at a fixed intervals of time period. Okay. Now, for example, A of delta of n minus n naught into x of n. Now, what is x? X is actual signal. What is delta? Impulse signal. Impulse is nothing but usually the strength of the impulse signal is taken as equal to 1. If it is taken as equal to 1, what is x into 1? X. What is y into 1? Y. Similar to that, x of n into delta of something, some function, delta function is going to be what now? Xn at that interval, xn at that finite interval of delta. So that is what the function normally you are going to get. Say for example, at a particular n naught, if you take a sample, you get a signal value at that sample. Therefore, that value is known as x of n naught signal I can write. So this is how we normally represent the discrete time signal. So what is important is sigma is important where n is going to extend between minus infinity to plus infinity. This is how we represent the discrete time signal. And last part is going to be sampling and interpolation. So what is sampling? We often want to able to now why we normally use the sample? Sampling is normally used to convert analog signal to a discrete signal. Whenever you want to convert signal from continuous time domain to discrete time domain, we normally use the sampling property. So this is accomplished through processes known as sampling and interpolation. What is sampling? Conversion from continuous time domain to the discrete time domain is known as sampling. Reverse is going to be the interpolation. It is as simple as that. So what is sampling? What is the input to the sampler? Imagine that it is a sampler or a sampling network. It is going to convert continuous signal to the discrete signal. So if for this sampler, what is the input? X of t, signal in time domain. What is the output? Signal in the finite domain, finite sequence domain. Now you normally going to get a finite sequence. So sampling process which is performed by a ideal continuous time to discrete time converter shown below transforms a continuous time signal x of t to a discrete time signal known as discrete time sequence or a discrete time signal. So normally we call it as a discrete time sequence. So y of n or y of n. So I can represent y of n like this or like this. Nothing will happen, but usually we prefer x of n with the rectangular brackets, y of n with the rectangular brackets. Okay, now next part is going to be the sampling and reconstruction part. So how do we normally perform sampling? Say if this is the original signal, imagine original signal is going to have some frequency. So now what we do now, how many times we are going to chop this signal with respect to the pulse train? It is based on the sampling theorem. Sampling theorem says that the sampling frequency should be compulsorily greater than or equal to 2 times the message signal frequency. That means the sampling means what? These are the samples. This is a signal now. This is an impulse signal now. The frequency of this particular signal should be compulsorily very much higher than the frequency of the message signal. Then only we normally going to say that it is going to satisfy the sampling theorem. Very, very important concept for us. So although sampling can be performed in many different ways, the most common scheme is going to be normally used for periodic sampling. That means we are usually consider periodic signals to sample very often, very commonly. So that means what? With this, a sequence Y of samples is obtained from the continuous signal X of T. So here we normally going to get a sequence, discrete time signal, according to the relation Y of N is equal to X of N into TS. What is this N into TS now? N is nothing but the discrete time domain representation. What is TS? TS is going to be the sampling time period. So therefore, now by applying this particular method with the sampling time period, we normally going to get the different samples. So now here, sampling period with T is equal to 7 has been shown. Now I have 7 samples for this particular signal. Okay, now that means I am going to chop this signal for 7 times. So I am normally going to represent this as a sample signal like this, right? So chopper signal is known as a sample signal. The sampling process is not generally invertible. What is invertible? That means we are going to convert continuous to discrete time. From discrete to continuous, if at all we want to convert, we won't get that much perfect values. That is what the meaning of this convertibility. Okay, so it is not invertible. That means I cannot really invert it quite easily. So in the absence of any constraints, a continuous time signal cannot usually be uniquely determined from a sequence of its equally spaced samples. So under certain conditions, we really cannot perfectly represent the continuous time signal from the discrete time signal, right? So that is what this particular concept, this is what one of the drawback of the sampling property. So in the absence of any constraints, a continuous time signal cannot be uniquely determined from the sequence of equally spaced samples. So say for example, I have taken two signals, x of t is equal to 0, x1 of t is equal to 0, x2 of t is equal to sine 2 pi t. Now when you convert this into the discrete signal, what are you going to have? When you convert them into discrete signals, you can simply say it as y1 of n is equal to x1 of nt, y2 of n is equal to x2 of nt. Now here I replace this particular time period with n now, 2 pi n. Now what will happen now? Based on the value of n, whatever may be the value of n, because I got here sine 2 pi is always equal to 0. When you come to time domain, based on the value of t, sine value is going to change. So therefore the sine of 2 pi t is not always 0, but whereas sine of 2 pi n is always going to be equal to 0. So in this case, what is the relationship that we have got now? y1 of n is equal to 0, y2 of n is equal to 0, while x1 of t and x2 of t is not going to be equal to 0 for all the time duration. So which means what now? It is not 100% convertible. Now in order to make it to convertible 100%, we are going to introduce a very important concept called interpolation. So by using interpolation concept, we are normally going to fill the gaps in order to construct the original message signal. So this is what regarding the unit number 1, which contains up to sampling and interpolation and also discrete time signals. Okay, and we normally going to have various classification of discrete time signals that we study in the second unit. Thank you very much for today.